Welcome to Salem Baptist Church. I'm so glad you're here this morning to worship with us on live Facebook. I have a few announcements for you that I want to share with you. The first one is Right Now Media is a great time for you to use that resource at our church because we have free access to thousands of videos for us to be able to stream them at home on our tablet or phone or through our Roku. So if you don't have that yet, you're welcome to text me your email, or you can email me your email and I can sign you up so you can use this great resource our church has for our members and visitors and for our attendees. We would love for you to be part of Right Now Media. It has great videos for children in groups of 10 or more. The next announcement is Wednesdays at 3 p.m. we are meeting at Zoom for the youth group, and we're watching the video series on Right Now Media called Jesus is Everything. And so if you have that, watch those videos, students, and we'll join Zoom at 3 p.m. every Wednesday until we can meet for youth group again. And this past week we had a great time. I mustered my face, and each week I'm going to slide my face with something different, so look forward to that. If you haven't purchased juice, maybe you can get juice and bread. If you already have it, hey, get it prepared. And when we have that service on Thursday at 7 p.m. this Thursday the 9th, we'd love for you to join us for communion to remember Christ as we enter into Easter season this year. Last thing I want to share is I just want to say a huge thank you to Scott and Sheridan and Corrine and Mike and everybody joining us this morning and helping to make this service go well on live Facebook. We miss all your beautiful faces. And lastly, I want to say a huge thank you to Pastor Kevin. He is back with us. Praise Jesus. So be praying for Pastor Kevin as he transitions back. As we are entering this state of emergency that we've been in, he's entering and leading us as the chief, and just God's using him. So I'm super excited about him being back. So please, please be prayer for him. Thank you.
We should be able to turn that thing all the way around, but we won't do that. Just say we are following the governor and the president's guidelines. There are fewer than 10 people in this great big room. And the second thing is to talk to a camera. It's not the same as talking to y'all. So I appreciate the 7 or 8 that are here, but I miss everybody. But it's good to be back. We had a great, there are 86 of you, and we're gonna hope that there's 3, 4, and 5 of y'all having watch parties, just no more than 10 of you having a watch party. But we're glad you're here for worship, and we're gonna get on with that. We had a great time away. You'll hear more about that in a couple of weeks. This is holy, some good things. Nothing went according to plan, but it was still great. And so we are glad to be home and getting back in the swing of things, whatever things are these days. Ministry has changed, as you well know. And in these times, the telephone is our way to connect. Call when you have a need, call the church office. You see on the announcements as they scroll, the office hours are changing some, but we're going to be sharing a link to the church phone or checking the machine. So we'll be staying in touch with you. Do practice the social distancing. If you drop something off, you know, keep your space. I did get an announcement request. Carolyn Farmer sent me a note. Mary Washington Hospital is requesting people to make 5,000, not a person, but total. They're hoping that citizens of the region can make up to 5,000 masks to help out as they are caring for folks. And as you watch the news, I don't suggest that you watch news while you're at home 24/7. It will just depress you. But when you watch the news and you see the numbers are rising, our medical professionals and those who are caring for those who are sick could use our help. So if you can sew, go online, get one of those little patterns of masks and make them. If you have questions, you can email Carolyn Farmer at cfarmer@bealnet.com. If you have questions and need to get them to the hospital, she can help you out with that. So we're going to do things a little different in just a moment. Corrine and Sheridan are going to lead us in a couple of worship songs. While they're singing, Shannon is monitoring the feed. And so some of you have commented and said, good morning, good morning. I think Amy Parker said, we're here now as long as the internet doesn't let us down, or something like that. There's a lot of that going on. But if you have prayer requests or a praise, we can't go through all of them, but to try to keep worship kind of what we're used to in Sparta with what we call porch time, or that time where we get to share with each other what's going on. Shannon's going to catalog some of those for me, and after worship, before the sermon, we'll have our prayer time and mention a few of those. So let's worship our Lord. I wish everybody was here. We're having a great time. I hope your living room was rocking and stuff. Just know this, everything's weird. Like some of you wondered, what a weird perspective. Well, we're trying to make it so that y'all can see the words of the outline or the PowerPoint and the singing, and just bear with us while we try to get this thing to work well. And we will never be a well-polished production, but that's not the goal. We just want to worship in spirit and in truth. So, a couple of you did log in with prayer requests. Sue Whittle mentioned her niece Abby, who's an ICU nurse, and lost her first patient to the virus at Chippenham Hospital, and pray for nurses and doctors. And that would extend to all nurses, doctors, first responders, medical folks in all areas. Regina also got some new hearing aids, and they're working, and that's making her life much better, so she is praising God for that. Talked with Pudney earlier this morning. CJ has a PET scan tomorrow, and later in the week we'll have a Zoom conference call with his doctor to figure out what to do to move forward for his treatment. Ray and Betty Ann Barlow's granddaughter Tracy, who is also, every call I've made as I'm on this, I can only do so many calls a day before I think I start thinking like a telemarketer. I don't. It's like, so I'll call and I'll call and I'll call and I'll call. And some of you talk great and you don't make me work hard and pull information out of you, and that's great. And I just listen. But when I, so anyhow, as I make one of my calls, all of my calls, virtually everybody asks, how's Brenda? How's Brenda? How's Brenda? Brenda's doing much better. They can't fix what got messed up with the surgery, but she's adjusting to a new normal and figuring out how to make that work. So we appreciate your prayers and thoughtfulness while we were away, and she was recovering from that. And then many of you know Randy Newsom. He's a fellow pastor here in the county. Randy is actually the godfather of pastors in the county. He's been at Round Oak 4 or 5 years longer than I've been at Salem. So it's just that he's on the very edge of the county, and folks kind of forget that he's up there sometimes, I think. But Randy was diagnosed with cancer 2 weeks ago, I guess, and will be beginning treatment. And just be prayerful for Randy and Beth and that church family, as that is just a challenging time for everyone. Shannon and Gail and Corrine and Mimi on our staff team, leader team. And then, of course, Jim Ayler did a great job. Learned some new technology to try to figure out how to fill in from Waynesboro. Jim, if you're watching, I did see last week with the sloth on the chair for an extended period of time, and we talked about that. They had a little technical glitch there, but that happened. So, but just appreciate everybody hanging in there. Who would have ever thought that we get to this crazy time? And there's so much to be prayerful for, so much to be thankful for, and just, so let's go to the Lord in prayer, and then we'll spend a few minutes in God's Word. Gathering in your name, and you still are God, and you still are Lord. Father, somehow you've got this, even though at times we don't feel like that's the case. Father, I pray for all those who are profiting off of and spinning up more fear and anxiety just for the sake of labs and dealing with patient care and trying to figure out the best way as a culture and as a people and as a country and as a world to stop this in its tracks. God, I just pray for all of them. Keep them strong and healthy and safe. Father, for those who are suffering, many who are hospitalized or being hospitalized and they're alone because their families aren't allowed in, Father, give them a peace that only you can provide. For the doctors, the nurses, the medics, the aides, the folks and the staff at hospitals that are just keeping the doors open to care for those in need, for the firefighters and the first responders and the EMTs that are making those response calls and don't know what they're stepping into. Father, for each of us that those who think this is overblown, those who think we're not doing enough, Father, for everybody, can you help us all just to keep calm heads? Can you help us to be smart and to do the simple things, to wash our hands, to wear a mask, to practice social distancing? But Father, while we do all that, can you help us just to realize that you call us to live at peace? God, for our government leaders, you want to make score political points in the midst of a worldwide health pandemic. Father, I pray that you shame them. Father, now is not the time for partisan politics. Now is not the time for pointing fingers. Now is the time to come together to help those in need. So, Father, we put all this in your hands because truly we don't know anything else to do. And it just seems too simple that the best thing we can do, stay at home and wash your hands. But, Father, that's what we can do. And while we're there, we can pray and we can spend time with you. We can turn up PER or whatever Christian music we love real loud in our homes. And Father, this does not have to be a time of despair. It can be a time of growth. It can be a time of spending time with you. So God, we give you this time, and now we give you this time of worship. We pray that you'd be honored and blessed by all that we do. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. It doesn't mess the world up if I do this so that I can see what pops up there, does it? Okay. Because we had a little slide difficulty. Our Pro Presenter software, I had nice little slides with backgrounds, and all of a sudden, Pro Presenter decided that wasn't appropriate or something, and it just wiped them out of there, so we just have words and blue. And blue's pretty. I like blue. But anyway, we'll move on. So how do you preach a sermon after you've been gone for 9 weeks? Do you realize I have never, in the last 30 years, not shared God's word for 9 weeks in a row? I don't know if that's proper grammar, never not. But I haven't had a period of 9 weeks when I haven't had the privilege of being able to share. And so I had a whole lot different idea in mind. It was going to come back. It was going to be Palm Sunday. And it was going to be so great because that's when we typically see attendance build up. And then Easter Sunday. And then a couple weeks ago, all this shelter in place and no church. And here we are. And it's a different day. And it's so easy for us, I think, in the midst of all of this, for us to just get upset about what we've missed and what's not normal and what we don't like and what we are frustrated by, and we miss the point that there's so much opportunity in this season if we will use it. So I'm hoping we're going to do that. Some of you remember a friend. He was at Calvary Baptist Church 10 or more years ago, 15 years ago now maybe, Dwayne Pemberton. Dwayne and I were good buddies in ministry. We still call and talk on the phone every now and then. They've been in Texas since then. And he called, and just out of the blue, I was driving somewhere, and he asked how the sabbatical was going, and I was filling him in on that. And then he said, well, I had this idea. And he said, he did a whole Sunday school lesson for his special needs fifth graders. It's really a sermon, but I'm not going to do the whole sermon. But the verse that he sort of jumped off, I said, I've never paid attention to this verse. And when he was here, we did some sermon series together where I'd take the last half of a passage, you'd take the first half, and we'd get together and we'd scratch our heads and come up with outlines and challenge each other. And sometimes they turned out pretty good. But he was the much better Bible scholar. So when he said, I've never paid attention to this verse before, have you? I knew I never had, because it would not have happened if he hadn't seen it before. So he read it to me, and I thought, isn't that interesting? And so we're going to back up from the Palm Sunday passage. We're going to finish with that. But we're going to go back in Mark chapter 10 instead of chapter 11. Because I think this verse is really cool. There it comes. I wonder if it's easier for me just to read it off of there. I'll read it in here. They were on their way up to Jerusalem. I'm in a different translation, though, I think. When Jesus was leading the way, the disciples were astonished
While those who followed were afraid, and then he took the 12 aside and he told them what was going to happen to him. And we'll get to that in a minute. They were astonished or amazed, and they were afraid. They were astonished and they were afraid. They were amazed and they... Isn't that an interesting choice of words? So you get the picture, and this says also that Jesus was out in front. That's the sort of the normal position for a rabbi as he walked with his followers. But I always envision Jesus' bunch as being, you know, you get a bunch of guys together and they're messing around and joking and walking, and whoever's telling something, they're all listening. I kind of figured it to be like that a lot. But so I get the picture in this passage that Jesus is kind of, he knows what's coming in Jerusalem. He knows without a shadow of a doubt what's going to happen. So he's kind of in thought. Maybe he's praying as he's walking. And you know, the 12, they're just kind of being them behind him, doing the thing. You know, they were a lot like us, y'all. They said the wrong thing, did the wrong thing, got it right sometimes. So they're walking along, and there's a picture. Jesus is in front, they're behind him, and the scriptures record that they were amazed and afraid. Two other times in Mark's gospel leading up to this, Jesus has referenced what was coming in Jerusalem. So the rest of this passage, if you've read ahead, the rest of this passage, the next two verses, are Jesus gets really specific about what's coming. Again, we'll get to that in a minute. I'm camping out on this amazed, filled with awe and wonder and afraid. Because while they're joking around, being the disciples, doing the things they always do, making their way toward Jerusalem, maybe they're trying to forget what he said. Maybe they're trying to say, oh, he really didn't understand what he was talking about. Surely that's not going to happen to him if he is the Messiah. Listen to everybody on the planet has read William Barclay's commentaries. And he put it really great this week while I was reading. They were sure that Jesus was the Messiah. They were equally sure that he was going to die. To them, these two facts did not make sense when we put them together. Does it make sense to you? They were completely bewildered, and yet they followed. To them, everything was dark except one thing. They loved Jesus, and however much they wished to, they could not leave him. They had learned something which is the very essence of life and faith. They loved so much that they were compelled to accept what they could not understand. They were compelled to accept what they could not understand. Friends, coronavirus in 2020, we are compelled to accept what we do not understand. Right? We don't understand how people are questioning, well, if God's good, how could he let this happen? And how could so many people die? And germs are a part of a broken, fallen world. They exist. Sometimes there's really bad ones. And you know, from the 1200s through now, there have been plagues and all kinds of viruses that have swept the world and wiped out hundreds of millions of people. This one might do that. It doesn't look like that's going to be the case. Yes, a lot of people have died, and more people will die, and it's terrible. It's terrible. But I don't think the coronavirus 19 is going to be the end of the world. It's going to be a very bad virus that messes up life and makes people sick and kills some people, and that's horrible. And we don't understand why it can happen. Why can't medical science do this? Why can't the government do that? Why can't? Well, I got lots of whys. Why do bad things happen to good people? Why do bad things happen to me or my family? Why? And on those, if you go down in that rabbit hole, you're not coming up for a long, long time. I don't know that we'll ever know the why. But we know the God who holds all our days in his hands. And because we love him, we accept this is the reality. For some reason, we are called for such a time as this. This is our day. This is the church's opportunity. Churches that are wringing their hands, we can't get together, we can't meet, the offerings are going down, and what are we going to do? I don't know. Stop thinking that way. Instead, how can we be the church out there while we're sitting in our living room going stir crazy, while we're doing laps inside the house, outside the house, while we're doing minimal trips to the grocery store, the hardware store to get a light bulb, and if you find toilet paper, God bless you. But while we're doing that, let's figure out how can we help people. We're trying to figure out, because the church facilities aren't being opened and their regular scheduling, our insurance people are telling us Glory Outreach can't be opening. Now's the time when Glory Outreach is really needed, but we got to figure out how to be able to do it and still be covered and all that stuff to make that happen. But how can churches have that? You have a senior adult that lives beside you that should not go out to the grocery store. Have you called them and said, I'm on my way to Food Lion. Can I pick anything up for you? Pick it up for them, set it on the front porch, ring the bell or call them and say it's on the front porch. And in that way, we get to be the hands and the feet of Jesus doing the very practical ministries. How many of you own a telephone? Most of you are watching worship on your telephone right now. Wear the telephone out. We were joking as we were getting ready for worship this morning. I almost picked up Mike's telephone. That our usage, our time online has increased. Our time using the phone has increased this way. Well, I turn it on while I'm working on something in the shop or doing something and it just goes. Let's increase our phone call time. You remember, that's what these were invented for. These were invented to dial and make a phone call. Not to be, it's amazing. You can watch movies, you can study for your PhD, you can do anything you need to do. I tried to get it to tell me why ProPresenter was eating the background of my slides. I did not find that yet this morning, but these were made to be phones that you call people up and you say, hi, how are you doing? Who is this? Well, this is Kevin, or this is, well, I just wanted to check in. Well, you've never called me before, but I'm calling you now because that's the way I can check in. You're in my Sunday school class. Well, yeah, I know, but we never talk. Well, we're going to get to talk now. Right? So, while I was away, the only thing I could figure that we can do to make this work, and we can actually have more contact than we ever have as a church family, and probably already have. If there are 200 to 250 of us, and if you take out, say, okay, 10% are going to be knotheads and can't do this, and maybe another 10% are too young to make the phone calls, maybe, we still have a lot of folks. And if everybody spent 5 to 15 minutes a day making 2 to 3 phone calls, we would call the whole church family every week, and then some. Right? When does that ever happen? It doesn't, but we can do it. This doesn't have to be a time for despair while we're amazed and afraid. But see, fear, if we focus on being fearful in the presence of Jesus, instead of amazed that we're in the presence of Jesus, when we're fearful, all we do is watch CNN or MSNBC or Fox News. Oh, no! And all we do is get upset and worried and worried. Is Jesus still, pray to God this does not happen. If 10 million people died, is Jesus still Lord? And that's not a number anybody's thinking of. It just popped into my head as a big, hairy, scary number. So where'd Kevin read that? 10 million? I made it up. If 100,000 people die in the U.S., that's terrible. But is Jesus still Lord? If somebody in our families gets it, is Jesus still Lord? Do I have it now? I really don't think I do, but I haven't done this for 9 weeks. My voice has not had to do this for 9 weeks. My point is, and the sermon, just so you know, two of the staff are here, they can tell I'm not lying. The plan was for the sermon to be 15 to 20 minutes. That was the plan, was it not? Then we said that because we wanted the whole service to be like 40 minutes, and none of that was in the notes. So let's move on. Yes, it was. It was about Mark 10, 32. So how do we hang out on the being amazed part instead of
the fearful part. When there's good reason to be afraid, when you go into the store and there's nothing on the shelves, on the bread aisle, or there's no toilet paper and paper towels, or you walk in and you see people masked up and gloved up, and you're like, I don't have any gloves. I left them in the car. What do I do? I touched the basket. Am I going to die? No, go wash your hands when you're done. Don't rub your nose and your eyes, and don't bite your fingernails. Just trying to be helpful. Okay, let's move on through the slides. Keep going. There we go. The realness in this text, I think, is what spoke to me. I could envision myself being one of those 12 and experiencing the emotions they're feeling. That I so love Jesus, I want to follow him. And I can't really believe the bad that's coming that he told me is coming is true. I just want to be with my friend. Anybody been there? A loved one gets a cancer diagnosis, and you don't want to believe it. You just want to be with them. You just want to stay close. And you know they've been put into hospice care, and you still just tell yourself, this can't be. I think that's the disciples. That's why they're amazed. I think, as Barclay said, they're a little bewildered, but they want to be with Jesus. And I think somehow they think when we get to the real day, this day of Palm Sunday, and there's that triumphal entry that comes in the next chapter, in chapter 11, and they come in and there's Hosanna, Hosanna, and they're waving palms and putting their jackets on the ground and signs of the king is coming, and the guy loans them the donkey for no good reason and doesn't shoot them or have them arrested or something. I'm sure all of the disciples went, yes, see, we knew it wasn't going to be like Jesus said. We knew it was going to be better. We knew it was going to all be okay. That's what our minds do. And then when we celebrate and come together Maundy Thursday, we're going to be reminded things changed a lot. Jesus knew all along where he was going and what the purpose was. Jesus knew that to come to Jerusalem meant the end of this thing has come. The pain is going to be real. He knew what it was going to cost to be the Savior of the world, whether his disciples understood it or not. Next slide. The disciples' fear, them being amazed and afraid all at the same time, there was no conversation recorded prior to that comment in the scriptures. So we don't know what Jesus was telling them up until then. But we do know that when we look back, and you, Scott, you don't need to flash back unless you want to the rest of that text. Jesus gets very particular, almost like a news report. Again, he took the 12 and told them what was going to happen to him. So they're going along. Maybe he hears them whisper. Maybe he hears, I don't know, but Jesus, while he's walking, maybe God tells him, hey, I think you need to tell him. And so he says, we're going to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They will condemn him to death. They will hand him over to the Gentiles, who will mock him and spit on him, flog him, and kill him. And 3 days later, he'll rise. How could you even hear that out of your friend, your hero, the one who is so bold? Barclay, earlier in the commentary, talked about two kinds of courage. There's a kind of courage where somebody jumps into a burning building just out of instinct because they hear a baby cry, and they run in, they grab the baby, and they run. They're a hero. They were so brave. They were so courageous. And then there's other courage. There's the courage of the soldier who knows going into the battle he might not come out. It's the law enforcement officer that knows, knocking on the door of a suspected drug house, that there's more guns on the other side than he's got. There's the courage of our Lord and Savior knowing what going to Jerusalem meant. That it was going to mean the pain, the emotional, physical terror of Gethsemane, and then the brutality of his arrest and crucifixion. And he knew all this. While they're walking toward Jerusalem, the guys didn't. He told them, this is the third time he's told them, and tell me, tell me, human beings, you just had 9 weeks of iHuman or something, so you're fully engaged human beings now. So tell me, how many of you, when you heard all that from Jesus, you're still walking with him, you get there and the crowd goes nuts and lays palm branches on the street for you to parade through as if you're the Messiah? How many of you remembered this? Or did you think, oh, that's not going to happen? See, Jesus, we had faith in you. I know you thought that, but, oh, Jesus, Messiah, you were wrong, and now it's all okay. Jesus is very clear about what's coming. I think for us in this crazy time we live in now is scary because we don't really know what's coming, do we? We don't know if the numbers are going to peak in Virginia. We don't know when is somebody inside our church family going to get this thing. We don't know when some loved one that we have folks attached to our church with family in other areas that have it. We have folks in our church family whose granddaughter and niece have it now. But we still got to believe that our God is God. Let's find in the slides I'm going to land this plane. We'll come back to that. Go on to the next one. There we go. While I was gone, I'm not a very good sabbatical taker, okay? So I didn't get a burner phone like one of my deacons suggested. I didn't stay completely out of touch. What I did do, though, I stayed mostly out of touch. I didn't stay on Facebook all the time, seeing what happened with everybody. I didn't follow everything that was going on, but I did follow some. And when this all broke, we all kind of agreed that I was going to be a part of the conversation. When these guys had to make this decision, we're closing the church buildings. And I was coming back 2 weeks later, and it was like, so I was engaged in that phone call, and then I got to thinking about things, and that was the time to start thinking about re-engaging anyhow, and what's the Lord saying we're going to do moving forward, and all that stuff. So that was cool, and I tripped upon David Jeremiah's, and I posted this, I reposted it. Some of y'all have already watched it, some of you already have the outline. Go watch it again, and again, and again, because I think one of our wise national pastors has given us what we need to remember in these crazy days. And on this Palm Sunday, when we can relate to the disciples, I hope, of that being amazed and being afraid, this helps us not be afraid and stand more amazed at Jesus. Okay? So, here we go real quick. I'm not going to do the whole sermon, but it's the best 32 minutes you could spend when you're done with worship here. Just find it on Facebook or his site or something. We've got time to concentrate on prayer. The Bible's clear. We're called to pray. Right? In everything. Don't be anxious, but with prayer. Don't be anxious about anything except Corona 19, something. No. Don't be anxious. Instead, with prayer and supplication, make your request known before God. Concentrate. Spend time and go, I'm not very good at praying. Then you got time to practice. Keep not looking at you guys in that thing. I got to look at Shannon because he's right in line with it. So take the time to pray. Well, Kevin, I don't know what to say. Then write it down. Write prayer letters to God. Well, I don't write very well. Then text prayers to God. He's listening. If you can pray with your thumbs better than you can pray with your head in silence or with your mouth, then pray with your thumbs. Control your mind. This is the big one. God's not giving us a spirit of fear, but of power, love, and self-control. So if you are mostly fearful, that's not coming from God. Okay? Fear's okay, but fear can't win the day. Because God will make a way. And then you can play all day. What's that? Oh, control your mind. Control your mind, Kevin. You're preaching in front of the camera online. Control your mind. Control my mind. Focus. Take
take the word of God at face value, and God wouldn't say that he's given us a spirit of self-control or a sound mind if we couldn't control it, right? So we can choose what to focus our hearts and minds. When you're really fearful, pray harder. Every time you watch the news, use it as, man, I need to pray for those doctors in New York. When the politicians on the other side of the fence from where you are make you so mad you want to see red, use it as a thing. I better pray. And pray for them. Nobody else is going to fix them. But the guy at the grocery store who worked at the grocery store and worked in grocery business for 25 years or something, he said, Pastor Jeremiah, in 25 years, I've never seen anything like this. And in a way that only David Jeremiah can say, he goes, so what do we have to praise God for? In 25 years, we have never experienced anything like this. Thank God that we've never experienced anything like this. And you can pray that we never will again. Count your blessings for your family that you have more time to spend with. I know there are parents who are going, I don't know what to do. Because they've never been at home this long with their kids, and all the places they'd like to take the kids they can't go, and the things they'd like to do. Learn new ways. Pray. Pray with your kids. Find ways to do things together. Pray for patience. Pray for their willingness to listen to you. Count your blessings. Claim your promises. Read the scriptures and all the things. God's promised to never leave you or forsake you. God's promised that he is Lord. God has promised you blessings beyond anything you can ask or imagine. Read the scriptures and claim what God has promised you. Consider your responsibility. We are the body of Christ. We jokingly about time I was getting ready to start, I think Corrine said, go team. And it was, we're God's team in this crazy broken world that has written the church off, where one less than bright mayor of a major U.S. city threatened to close the churches down permanently if they didn't listen to him. Can I just tell you, you do not have the right nor the authority from the government, and certainly not from God, to close a church permanently. Go ahead and try. Can't be done. We have a responsibility to our God and to each other to be on our telephones, to be texting, emailing. Here's a wild thought. This is an ink pen. This is a piece of paper. You can write, Dear Shannon. I've been thinking, you can write a real letter to somebody. And I'll bet you've got some of those freedom stamps that are supposed to last forever that you paid 32 cents for that are supposed to still be good. Because nobody writes letters anymore. Write a real letter, because the only exercise some people are getting are walking to their mailbox, and they don't want to get one more sales ad from a company they can't go to their store anyhow. But they'd love to get a personal letter, note card from a friend, family member, loved one. Are those serving overseas? Your friends that are EMTs, medics, nurses, doctors, nurses' assistants. Don't forget those who work at our nursing homes. And you'll brighten their day. I think that's some of our responsibility. And continue the work. You say, well, I can't. They won't let me go to work. I can't get into my office. That's not the work I'm talking about. Sure, keep that up as much as you have to. But the work that we're responsible for is children of the King. Guys, I don't know what the future... I have never pastored when I can't go visit somebody. I've never pastored when I can't walk into the hospital. I've never pastored when everybody is so focused and afraid of one thing. But this one thing I know is that I still stand amazed before the God who loves us. And he's going to make a way for his church and his name and his word and his salvation to be known by the world that so desperately needs him. And it's our job to be a part of that. It's great being back. Let's pray. Our Father and our God,
I thank you for the privilege to come to your word. I thank you that the disciples were real human beings, that they were amazed and in wonder and awe of their friend that they knew was Messiah, and yet they were afraid. And God, I can relate to that. And Father, in these trying times, it's easy to be afraid. It's easy to be overwhelmed and to think that this virus has more power than it really does. Father, I pray for those that have died, that their families would come to know you and your grace and your love. Father, for those that are sick, for those that are yet to come down with it or die, God, I just pray that somehow in the midst of all that, they'd bump into one of your people and they'd know your love and your grace. Father, I pray that this is a season of a great movement of God in the midst of such fear and chaos. And God, whenever you show up and do that good thing that only you can do, we'll give you all the honor and glory. For it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Guys, it's great to be back. There's a couple things I'd remind you of that are upcoming. Several of you keep suggesting that we look into the drive-in church. We are looking into that. We've got some technology that might can work. Staff kind of felt like, let's see, they're saying this thing's getting ready to peak, and what's that going to look like? But we're checking out the legalities of all that. So we're looking at maybe doing that after Easter. Maundy Thursday, I hope that will be a holy time of worship around your table with your family. We're just going to walk through an abridged version of what we usually do on Maundy Thursday. We'll be here in the sanctuary. It'll be live at 7 o'clock on Facebook Live. But really the holy ground moments, I think, will be as you gather around your table with your family or whoever you're in the house with, that you can come before the Lord and remember his sacrifice. So I pray that you would do that. I pray, too, that you would take seriously the request to be, Kevin, I don't know who to call. Well, call the church office. We'll give you some names. Think of one person you know in the church to call. And when you call them, ask them, who do you think I should call? Call some of our new folks that don't know anybody very well yet. And we can share in this together. Deacons are gonna keep calling and doing what they've done great. I think it's a great new day for us to be the family of God. So let's keep our eyes open and keep coming before him. And we will... Oh, one other thing that we're hoping and we're praying. You can pray on this. One other thing we're trying to work out. We're trying to have more ongoing presence during the week, like maybe a daily devotional thought that me and Shannon and some church leaders, that maybe every day there can be a something. We haven't worked all the details yet, but maybe this week we'll have that worked out. Certainly by after Easter, there'll be some way for you to check in with your church family, get a little word of hope each day by logging on. One last group I'd like you to be sure to remember. Make some of the folks on the top of your list to call. The folks that you know aren't online. We're trying to work out how to do an audio recording that we could send a link to so that folks just with a dumb phone could click on an audio file, maybe, or that we can re-up the CDs or something. We just want to, because we realize that a decent percentage of you are online. That's great. But we're missing a lot of folks, and we want to find a way to connect with them too. So call them first. Fill them in on the crazy message that bounced all over the place a little bit, but remind them that we can stand in awe and be amazed and face our fears. Yeah. Okay. Love you guys. We'll see you on Thursday. Mm-hmm.